We live in the information age, in which information is indeed far more accessible than ever before. But so is misinformation. How do we sort out one from the other? Well, some people who call themselves fact checkers claim to have the answer. They say, trust us. But all too often, they fail to get even basic facts correct. Let's take a look at three examples. See if you notice a common thread between them. Late during the Supreme Court nomination hearings for Brett Kavanaugh, several women accused him of sexual assault, a very serious and horrible crime. And the media began to publish many facts about sexual assault, most of them claiming that false allegations are very, very rare, giving the clear message that Kavanaugh's accusers are probably telling the truth. That's when a fact checker named Snopes stepped in and claimed that the most recent and credible research on this topic shows that around 5% of sexual assault allegations are false. Snopes writer Alex Kasparak based this claim mainly on a meta-analysis of seven studies. However, the meta-analysis doesn't say this. Instead, it states that at least 5% of such accusations are confirmed false reports, and many more false report cases potentially exist. In fact, the analysis lists four different studies with suspected false report allegation rates of at least 40%. Surely, Snopes knows that the words at least 5% and potentially many more don't mean around 5%. If that wasn't enough, the very same Snopes article slanders Mississippi State Senator Chris McDaniel by claiming he alleged that 99% of sexual assault allegations are false. McDaniel didn't say that. He was talking about accusations dredged up by the American left at politically opportune times, many years after the alleged incidents took place. He was not talking about all sexual assault cases, and no competent, honest reporter could mix up his words in the way that Snopes did. Let's look at another enlightening example. In the final presidential debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, Clinton said that about half of all illegal immigrants actually pay federal income taxes. A Pulitzer Prize-winning fact-check organization called PolitiFact looked into Clinton's claim and reported, while there is no official figure, experts estimate that about half of all undocumented workers pay federal income taxes, if not more. In reality, the polar opposite is true. Data from the Congressional Budget Office, the IRS, and the Social Security Administration show that virtually no illegal immigrants pay federal income taxes. Instead, they file federal tax returns to receive refundable child tax credits, which are a form of welfare. Are we supposed to believe that PolitiFact doesn't know the difference between filing tax returns to receive welfare and paying federal income taxes? Now let's examine a fact-checking operation embedded in a major media outlet. Well after Obamacare was signed into law, the Congressional Budget Office estimated that it would reduce the size of the U.S. workforce by about 2.3 million full-time workers. This was roughly three times larger than the previous estimate. As this negative news began to spread, the Washington Post's head fact-checker, Glenn Kessler, put a positive spin on it by claiming that this decline in workers, quote, initially would lead to higher wages as employers competed to hire people, unquote. However, in direct contradiction to this, the same Congressional Budget Office report that Kessler cited says that the Affordable Care Act will cause, quote, reductions in wages or other compensation, unquote. Moreover, it explains that these wage reductions are one of the main reasons why Obamacare will cause the workforce to decline. Since people will be paid less, less people will be willing to work. Even a child can read a report that says wages will decline and know that it doesn't mean wages will rise. Why can't the Washington Post head fact checker or his editor do that? This is the same media outlet that ran a Super Bowl ad praising journalists for empowering the public, helping us to make good decisions, and keeping us free. These cases are all clear as a bell and inexcusable under basic standards of honesty, much less these highfalutin journalism guidelines these organizations claim to adhere to. Worse still, when I brought these blatant falsehoods to the attention of these so-called fact checkers, not one of them made a correction. So what's the common thread here? They all mislead in ways that support progressive political agendas. This is not a coincidence. I've examined countless fact checks that are rife with deceit, and in nearly every case, it's the same story. They mangle the truth in ways that advance leftist narratives. Why would they do that? I can't read their minds, but this can only boil down to one of two things: incompetence and/or dishonesty. So if you are someone who values the truth and understands its importance, make it a point to take nothing at face value from these groups and others like them. They've proven time after time that they just can't be trusted. I'm Jim Agresti, president of Just Facts.